Hello, and welcome to this video on grain morphology in fusion welds. To begin with, let me start by sharing the screen so you can follow along with the PowerPoint that I'm going to use. My name is Girish Kelkar, and I am a welding consultant operating as WJM Technologies. Additional information about my consulting business is on the web at welding-consultant.com, and you're going to find this video on my YouTube channel at Weld Nugget. So in this video, we're going to look at grain morphology in fusion welds. That means look at what is the size and shape of the grains that can form during welding. Here I'm showing you a schematic on the left, which shows an arc welding process where the arc is struck through the electrode. You have formed a certain amount of molten metal, and then you have the base metal surrounding it. When the arc is turned off, the source of energy is cut off, and now the cooling through the base metal takes over and rapidly freezes the molten metal into solid form. During this process, there's a certain method to the madness in forming these grains, and that's what we're going to look at. Here I'm showing you a schematic where the arc has been turned off, but still the hottest point or hottest zone in the weld is going to be right here where the arc was active. You have the molten metal zone, and you have the solid metal around it, and this boundary is called the fusion boundary. So once the heat has been turned off, there's a rapid loss of heat through the base metal, and the weld starts to cool down. During this process, grains start to grow from the outer edge of the boundary, and they grow into the weld. In this particular schematic, I'm just showing you a single grain, which has been initiated from one of these grains right on the boundary, and the grain is sucking the heat away from the liquid fused zone in this particular direction, and the grain is now growing in the opposite direction into the fused metal. Now, these grains which start from the outside, from the original nucleus grains on the outer edge, and these is called heterogeneous nucleation. These grains are usually elongated, and there are different more finesse distinguishing between different types of grains, such as planar, cellular, and columnar. But that is more graduate school stuff. So if you're interested in getting that deep into that subject, there are plenty of textbooks and papers on that subject over there. But for the purpose of this video, we're going to call them elongated grains. These elongated grains form primarily because of the large temperature gradient. So this is molten metal, this is solid metal, and much, much cooler. So there's a huge temperature gradient, plus there's a lot of molten metal here for the grains to grow. Because the grains have to grow, they have to actually attract suitable metallurgy from the molten metal in order to grow in that particular direction. Now let's look at the growth direction of the grains. Here I'm showing you two different welds. One is a slightly shallower weld, such as in, say, arc welding, and one is a slightly deeper weld, such as in, say, laser beam and electron beam welding. What you will notice is that these elongated grains, when they initiate from the boundary, they initially tend to grow perpendicular to the grain boundary at that location. So that the direction of growth over here. And then they start to grow towards a hot zone. In this particular case, in shallow welds, this direction and the hot zone are in the same line, and you will notice that these grains seem to be growing towards that center point. In welds which are deeper, as in laser beam and electron beam welds, we find that the grains will initially start growing, and then they kind of bend towards the hot zone. So sometimes you feel that the grains are actually taking a different turn. And we can see that in examples I've shown you on the next slide. This is a cross-section of a gas metal arc weld, which is a shallow and a wide weld. So you can see the width of the weld on the surface is quite wide, and the depth is less than that. And here you can see that the grains which are growing from the outer edge are starting to grow perpendicular to the fusion boundary, and they keep growing towards the hot zone, and they all go in the same direction. On the right-hand side, I'm showing you a laser weld, in this case, a deeper, narrower weld, and you will notice that at the deeper locations, you will find that the grains in the beginning, they do start growing perpendicular to the grain boundary, but then actually turn and start growing towards the hot zone. So you can see that in certain locations where they start growing and then they turn upwards. Again, it doesn't have to be the same grain. Sometimes one grain starts growing and then it is taken over by another parallel grain and it starts growing in a certain direction. In the extreme case, in electron beam welding and laser welding, you can make very deep, narrow welds. And these welds are formed by a process called keyhole welding. If you're not familiar with laser welding, please, there's a video on my YouTube channel which covers that topic of how keyholes are formed. And during laser welding or even electron beam welding, the keyhole opens up, and now the laser energy is actually able to go deep into the weld. So instead of having a single hot zone, you actually have a hot line which is right down the center of the weld. At the end of the weld, when the laser or electron beam is turned off, now we have a line which has a very high temperature, and the cooling is happening from the outside, and we'll find that the grains actually grow right perpendicular to the vertical line, and they grow from the edge of the weld right down to the center line, which is the hot zone in the weld. And you can actually kind of see that hot zone over here, and you can actually see these grains growing from outer edges towards the center line. Let me see if I can expand this, and actually, you can see the grains over here. You can see some of the grains growing and contacting, coming down to the center line. Okay. On the next screen, we can see growth direction in resistance welds. Again, the same thing happens in resistance welding. You have the fusion zone. The only difference is the fusion zone is contained on the inside, and it is surrounded by solid metal, and also the electrodes are taking a lot of the heat out. So at the end of the weld, when you turn the resistance, the current off in resistance welding, the fusion zone starts to solidify and towards the hot zone. In this case, the hot zone is actually a line along the center of the weld. So here we can see the external grains are growing from the outside towards the center line, and you have rapid, long, elongated grains from the outside edge to the inside edge. All these examples I've shown you are dominated by elongated grains, but there are situations where you also get what is called Equiaxed grains. So what happens is when the weld starts to cool and these elongated grains are forming, when the elongated grains cool, they try to solidify in a more pure form, and they push a lot of the contamination and even additives into the center. Secondly, when these grains are cooling, when these elongated grains are cooling, they are actually pushing out some of the heat into the center. So the net result is that the chemistry of the molten metal in the center is now different. And the temperature gradient is also different. The temperature gradient is much lower by the time the center portion starts to cool down. So now, instead of elongated grains, we have sometimes the growth of equiaxed grains. Equiaxed grains are grains which have the same direction, the same dimensions in all directions, and they are not dependent on nucleation from other crystals. So these are formed homogeneously. That means they do not need nucleating sites from other grains. They find their own nuclei in that region over there. So here we can see in the cross section, we have a mixture of elongated grains on the outside and equiaxed grains in the center. Now these equiaxed grains in this particular case are roundish, kind of almost like circular, like small spheres, but sometimes they can also be dendritic. And I'll show you an example of that in the next slide. Here we have a butt weld between two Inconel 625. They are welded with a ER 625, which is a filler wire, which has additives for as grain refiners, such as aluminum and titanium. In butt welds, especially in thin plates, you will notice that the volume of material available for cooling, the solid metal on the outside, which is going to provide the heat loss by conduction, is much less compared to the volume of molten metal. So we have this was a volume of molten metal, and then we have cold metal on the outside for cooling, which is exactly opposite of typical welds in, say, laser welding and arc welding, in, say, fillet welds, where you have a large volume of solid metal surrounding the weld and thus providing very rapid heat loss. As opposed to that, in butt welds, we do not get that much rapid heat loss, plus the volume of, plus it can also have additives from the filler wire, which can encourage formation of these equiaxed grains. So in this particular cross section, we can see that there are two zones on outer edges. Of course, this is a cross section, so this is a, the weld is like a circle. And you can see on the edges, we have elongated grains. And then we have a large region in the center, which is equiaxed, in this particular case, dendritic. And if you look at these welds at higher magnification, they look like small, tiny dendrites. They look like plus shapes all over the place. So here we have a mixture of elongated as well as dendritic grains. So what is the difference and what are the benefits? Actually, elongated grains are actually not that good for the performance of your weld. You're more likely to form solidification cracking in elongated grains because elongated grains, being long, they tend to expel a lot of the impurities along the grain boundaries, and that's where you can get solidification cracking. I have already posted a video on solidification cracking on my YouTube channel, so feel free to take a look at that. Elongated grains also have poor fatigue strength because many of these grains do not have isotropic properties. So they have different properties and different grain orientations. So when you flex a weld like that, the bending of these long grains might be different in different orientations, and that can lead to separation of the grains and fatigue cracks growing from between the grains. There's also a greater chance of helium leaking. So when these grains are very long, sometimes going all the way from the inner edge of the weld to the outer surface of the weld, and even a fine separation along the grain boundaries can lead to leaking of helium from the inside to the outside. As opposed to that, the equiaxed grains have much less chance of solidification cracking because these individual grains are very, very tiny, so they are not expelling that much impurity elements outside. They have much higher fatigue strength because they are, again, very small and equiaxed. And there's also much lower chance of helium leaking along the grain boundaries because now the grain boundary path is very tortuous from inside to the outside and much less likelihood of that happening. However, unfortunately for us, it is more common to have majority elongated grains because of the rapid cooling from the surrounding material. And so this is something very important for you to evaluate. So next time you get a weld and you need to evaluate that, make sure you're not just looking at the typical defects such as cracks and porosities and undercut and penetration depth. Again, those are important too, but you should also look at the size and shape of the grains which have formed in the weld. There's always an exception to the rule. This is a laser weld in titanium, and it's a very small weld, typical for medical devices, and you can see that you do not have a very obvious elongated grains along the boundary. And this typically I have seen that in grade 2 titanium. And I'm not sure why that happens in titanium and not in other alloys. But most alloy systems, such as steel, stainless steels, aluminum, copper, and nickel alloys, typically will exhibit a mixture of elongated and equiaxed grains depending on the metallurgy, size, shape, cooling rate, and so on. So, in summary, solidification process starts from the fusion boundary. So as soon as you turn off the energy source, these grains will start growing from the boundary. And the grains which are already there along the fusion boundary will act as nuclei. And the elongated grains grow from those nuclei into the fusion zone. These grains typically start by growing perpendicular to the fusion boundary, but then can change direction towards the hottest part of the weld, and that can happen depending on how deep or narrow or shallow the weld is. There are situations where in the last portion of the fusion zone, which solidifies, which is towards the center of the weld, may have conditions such as due to reduction in the cooling rate and also change in chemistry, that you might form a zone which has equiaxed grains. Now, these equiaxed grains also can be roundish or could be dendritic. So most welds will have a mix of both, many a times dominated by elongated grains, but in some cases I've shown, as in butt weld, there is significant amount of dendritic grains as well. Well, thank you for your patience in watching this video. If you're interested in learning more about welding and joining, please subscribe to this YouTube channel. There are multiple videos and different playlists, such as laser welding, arc welding, resistance welding, and feel free to go through all of those. There are, I think, now about 42 videos on different topics, and I hope you find something interesting in all of them. I want to thank you once again for your patience in watching this video, and wishing you the very best in learning more about welding. And take care.